unfortunately,
I'm still
it's
gonna
not
have my face
because
I wasn't able to.
Will
I just wanted to start recording.
Continue to increase, and hopefully that will. Hopefully, all of you will stay safe. This morning, we're going to continue on and finish off chapter 12, and then we're going to move on and finish chapter 15, and then next week, I expect we'll start chapter 16. In terms of exams, I'm still waiting for details from the university. The university's trying to come up with an appropriate solution, and they haven't quite come up with it yet, but I expect that they'll be coming up with one soon. Any questions for me? Oh, no. This is what happens when you have a cat walking around.
Hey, no. Stop it. I'm sorry.
So,
but she's going to knock it.
And
push her down.
Green
get up.
Cute. Yes, my cat is cute. I don't know if you saw the cat or not, but yes.
You want to go watch it?
Seeing me? You should be able to see. You want to see the cat. Right now, I've got it so that it works for the showing up the screen because I was asked to redo question C on the homework 19Q. So I was going to go through that first. Yes, you don't get to see, unfortunately. Maybe we'll get to see the cat later. The cat may not be so enthralled by my lecture, however, and so the cat may run away to go someplace else. Let's first of all start with the starting with the homework. So shown here is the homework from lipid structures, and people wanted a cerebroside drawn. And so in this case here, we asked you to draw a cerebroside with a C14 saturated fatty acid and glucose.
Oh, my face looks so good now.
So the first thing I always recommend people do is to draw the sphingosine. And the sphingosine is going to be a C18 carbon chain, and it actually surprisingly has a trans double bond in it. I know we told you most fatty acids have cis, and that's correct. But in the case,
I can tell you do.
We have a
trans
double bond. Let me go and draw an 18 carbon structure here.
I can tell. Sorry, I just wanted to see if it was responding to my voice because when I speak and I'm recording, it says you're muted.
And so that's going to be 18 carbon. We have 2, 4. So we're going to have 18 carbons there. And so what we're going to do now is we know that in sphingomyelins and these cerebrosides, what happens is because they're based upon sphingosine has a double bond between C14 and C15. And so we put the double bond in here. There, that's a nice double bond. So the exam is going to be for a couple of weeks because I've had a we're waiting for guidance at this point. The test is not going to be today. It's probably not, and it's not going to be next week. It could be the week following that. So here for the cerebroside, we put a double bond in between 14 and 15, and we do not a 16. We're going to have a OH. On 17, we're going to have a NH, and because this has a fatty acid, I'm going to put an amide bond there. And so here we have the amide bond at C17, and then at C18, this is where the sugar is going to go and appear. And so therefore, that's kind of what it's going to go and look like. Now we ask for a C14 saturated fatty acid. And so therefore we have 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Uh-oh.
What the living fuck?
11, 12, 13, 14. So that's 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, and then 14. And so that way you the 14. Yes, that's 14. Ene is at position 14 to position 15. So let me put 15 here. It's going to be there because it is next to it. And then here, what happens is we have to attach glucose. And so glucose, I didn't specify whether it's going to be alpha or beta. In this case here, I'm just going to go and make it beta because it's going to be easier to fit in the space. And so therefore, here, just here. Let me try drawing that a little bit better.
What is going on,
there,
sir?
Will be glucose. Yes, the 12 up top is unrelated to that particular structure. It was related to the question B. I left over the answers from the other one. Can I scroll that? Sure, but that's the bottom. Let's see. Is that going to be helpful? Not quite sure what you guys see, so it makes it a little harder for me, but I think this should work here. Okay, so that finishes up the worksheet for the first worksheet from chapter 12. Everybody asked I go back and do that again, so I went back and did that. What we're going to do now is go and take a look at the PowerPoint for chapter 12. So I'm going to finish off the PowerPoint for chapter 12, and then we can go and take a look at chapter 15. So let me start off with chapter 12 here. Let me move this over, and let's see if I don't want to do that. Can everybody see a PowerPoint slide now? If you see a PowerPoint slide, please let me know. Okay, no PowerPoint slide. No PowerPoint slide, okay. Let me go and see if I can do the wonderful. Okay, any luck with a PowerPoint slide now? Nope, no luck with a PowerPoint slide now. Okay, let's see. Any luck now? Nope, negative. Okay, so let me go and try back to plan B. we'll try plan B. Okay. Good now. Okay. One problem solved. Onwards and upwards. So let's go and try this one here then. So what happens here is this is the hydropathy plot. We went through the hydropathy plot yesterday, and I think we answered most questions there. So what we're going to do now is just move on and finish off here. Yesterday again, last class, we talked about diffusion. We talked about lateral diffusion, which means diffusion across the surface from, you know, in effect, floating on the surface of the lipid bilayer. And then we talked about transverse diffusion, where you flip from one side of the lipid bilayer over to the other side of the lipid bilayer. And in this case here, lateral diffusion tends to be very rapid. Transverse diffusion tends to be very slow. Pretty much proteins don't undergo transverse diffusion. And so really, you're not going to see that. Lipids do, but again, only very slowly. So as here, transverse diffusion can be is very slow. Lateral is going to be fast. And you can really move from one end of a bacterium to the other in about a second. Thank you. For some reason, Siri just turned on for me. Okay, fine. And so therefore, what happens here is proteins, again, unless they're attached to the cytoskeleton, don't move. Shown here is a fluid mosaic model. In this case here, what happens is we again have a sea, and we have proteins in the sea of lipids. Last kind of idea for the chapter that I really want to get across is that we have a melting temperature for these lipids. And this idea here is relatively simple. It's the fact that if you go and take, let's say, butter, and you stick butter in a frying pan and you turn on the heat, the butter is going to go and melt. And therefore, what happens here is... on the diffusion slide. Oh no. Okay. Let's see what I can do. Is that better? Can everybody see a slide on melting now? Okay. So what we're going to do now is discuss membrane fluidity and melting temperature. And so what happens is something like butter, when you go and put it in the frying pan, what happens is it goes from being solid-like to being liquid-like. And the temperature at which that transition occurs is called the melting temperature. And for fatty acids, that depends upon the length of the fatty acid chain, and even more so, it depends upon the degree of unsaturation. And generally, the longer the fatty acid chain, the higher the TM is going to be, and the more unsaturation you have, the lower the TM is going to be. And by the way, the cat is really excited about the garbage truck. So I'm looking out the window with garbage truck now. and so therefore, that saturation lowers the TM. If we take a look here, and we take a look at the number of carbons in a chain, the number of double bonds, and the melting temperature. First of all, what I'd like you to notice is that the number of carbons is even number. And so therefore, here, because those are only the ones you're going to find. So we have 18, 16, 18, all going to be saturated fatty acids. That means they don't have any double bonds. And so therefore, what happens here, you'll notice the melting temperature goes down by, you know, about, you know, whatever, 17 degrees for every 2 CH2 groups that you add between 14 and 16. On the other hand, if notice the 18 one, when you go and add a double bond, the melting temperature goes down by about 80 degrees. And so what this is that if you go down by 80 degrees, the double bond clearly makes a big difference. And the reason the cis double bond makes a big difference is that, as you can see on the picture here on the right side, what happens is it puts a big kink in the structure. That means that the chains cannot come together. If they're together and have good acting, that's going to result in higher TM. On the other hand, if they have unsaturated ones, the TM is going to become much lower. I should point out that you have a trans double bond. What happens with the trans double bond is it looks much more like the structure on the left than the structure on the right. And so with the trans double bond, you don't affect the melting temperature very much. Cholesterol is used in animals to go and affect the melting temperature of the membrane. Is not used in plants. That's why plants, if you want to eat low cholesterol food, you eat lots of plants. Bacteria control their membrane fluidity by going and adjusting the number of double bonds and the length of the fatty acid chains. And so again, they do it that way. They don't do it with cholesterol like we do. Of course, butter cleanses cholesterol because that comes from animals. Margarine, which comes from plants, is does not, of course, have double bonds. So cat spotting, no, I will see what I can do at the end. If we have time, I will see if the cat's still around and we can do some cat spotting. The other thing about membranes is to realize is that they are asymmetric. And if they're asymmetric, one side of the membrane does not look like the other. So the extracellular side doesn't look like the intracellular side. Shown here is the potassium sodium pump. Again, in this case here, the sodium goes out, the potassium comes in. Once again, the concentration of sodium inside your cell is low, and outside your cell is high. Potassium is the inverse, again, of your brain. We have outer membrane, inner membrane, and cell wall. And this would be one type of bacteria. Another type just has one membrane. For the bacteria that have outer membranes, as I mentioned previously, you have a pore in the outer membrane, and that pretty much lets everything through. and then you have your cell wall in between, along with the lipoproteins. And then you have your inner membrane. The inner membrane bacteria is pretty much impermeable. What is the color of my cat? Yes, well, hopefully we'll get to see that. So just to finish off, shown here are the fact that we have lots of membranes and we have signals that target proteins to particular membranes. This here ends the portion for chapter number 12. We're not going to cover chapter number 13 and 14. We will go now and cover chapter 15. No, you don't get to run and chase after the garbage truck. So what we're going to do now is move on and take a look at metabolism. And metabolism is what is going to be for the rest of the semester. In chapters 15, 16, 17, and 18, we're going to study glucose metabolism, or mainly carbohydrate metabolism. And we're going to study how we go from glucose to carbon dioxide and water. Now, we'll also mention fructose and galactose and a few other things, but mainly it's going to be focused on glucose. And so before we go and give you examples of metabolism, what we want to do is give you some basic concepts that are reoccurring in metabolism. As you imagine, you would like metabolism to be as simple as possible. And one way of making metabolism simple is to have a lot of steps that are reoccurring and use the same basic features. And so while there's lots of different enzymatic reactions out there, a lot of the enzymes work in very similar manners. And so an example of that is we have kinases. And kinases transfer a phosphate group from ATP to something else. And the mechanisms of most of these kinases are very, very similar. And so generally they bind ATP, they change the structure, they then bind the substrate, transfer the phosphate, and then they go and make the corresponding product. Kinases, by the way, are always named after the least phosphorylated species, irrespective of which direction is shown in the metabolic pathway. Phosphatases, which we've shown before, likewise, are also very generic, again, have similar sort of mechanisms. And so what we're going to try and do is show you general classes of reactions that place today, and then you guys can study those classes of reactions, and later on we take a look at chapter 16 and glycolysis and gluconeogenesis, we'll take a look at some of the actual mechanisms. Please, if you have a chance, somebody just raise their hand, but if you type it into the chat, that would be great, because I'm not able to take care of people with hands very easily. So let's take a look now at the basic concepts for metabolism. And metabolism really goes and answers several fundamental questions. It tells you how the cell extracts energy and reducing power from its environment. So it tells us how we get the energy to run. It tells us how to go and get the reducing power we need from the environment, because generally we're a very oxidizing environment. We also go and use our metabolism to synthesize building blocks, macromolecules, and then macromolecules themselves. So for protein synthesis, that's an example of a metabolic pathway. Now, there are more than 1,000 chemical reactions that take place in E. coli, which is a relatively simple organism. We don't want you to memorize all 1,000 humans. There's, you know, thousands upon thousands, but we do want you to go and understand that many of these are repetitive, and we'll tell you some of them that are going to be repetitive. And again, this highlights the fact that the number of reactions is large, but the number of kinds of reactions is small. Again, we want to keep it simple. Again, also the mechanism, again, are generally quite simple, and we'll show you that in the next few chapters. And regulation is something that's going to be important going forward. So what's going to be important going forward is you need to understand and really, quite frankly, memorize to some extent the metabolic pathways. You also need to go and understand how they are regulated, and you need to know the mechanisms that are shown. And in terms of the metabolic pathways, people think they're a lot more complex than they really are. It's much better to understand pathways, understand the reactions that take place, and then the enzyme names become very simple, and the actual pathways become a lot simpler to follow. Somebody else has a cat. That's good. And shown here are the common motifs that we're going to talk about in metabolism. The first one is fuels are degraded and larger molecules are constructed in a step-by-step series of reactions. And that's not unexpected. That's called the metabolic pathway. And there are a few central molecules that are going to be very important for metabolism. And one is ATP. And ATP is a carrier of a high energy phosphate, and it goes and links the energy state of the car, of the cell to the actual pathway. So generally, if you have lots of ATP, you don't want to do lots of things. If you have low ATP, you're not going to want to do very much. And so therefore, in that case here, some of the pathways are going to be regulated by the amount of ATP. Lots of ATP, turn them on. Little ATP, turn them off. And the way that we go and make this ATP is in fact the same way as your car goes and takes energy. We in effect go and oxidize carbon. The carbon that we oxidize comes normally from either sugars or fats, but it can also come from elsewhere, such as proteins. However, in this class, we're going to focus on sugars. If you go and take biological chemistry too, they will go and add up about fats. And what you find is that there are many intermediates and reactions that are common to the pathways. As I mentioned before, regulation is something that's highly important to follow. And so in terms of energy, there are several different types of energy. What we are going and doing is we're going to go and look at energy in terms of mechanical work. You've already taken a look at that in terms of myosin. And so there, ATP is used to, in effect, change the conformation of myosin, which then goes and results in movement. And there are also other things that are used for cellular movement, which we'll cover in chapter 18. Energy is also used to transport molecules, ions, across membranes. They're also used to synthesize these molecules. And please remember, organisms, they're in a state far from equilibrium. If we happen to pass away, then we go and change our equilibrium, our concentration of molecules in our cells very dramatically and very quickly. And so therefore, that's what takes place. So again, we're far from equilibrium. And cells get their energy from several different sources, or two main different sources. One is phototrophs. So let me ask the first question, are we phototrophs? No, we're definitely not phototrophs. We do not get energy from the sun. Although your dog may like to be out and your cat may like to be outside sunbathing, we do not get energy from the sun. However, we get energy from what we eat. So we're called chemotrophs because we get energy from the sugars and fats that we eat. Shown here are a picture of metabolic pathways for E. coli. We expect, of course, that you're going to remember every single reaction in this picture. Is that okay? No. Yeah, that's right. We do not want you to do that. We're going to focus on the reactions that are actually in blue, in dark, or I should say in bolded blue. And those are reactions that we're going to focus on. We're not going to focus on the other reactions. If you go and take biological chemistry 2, then they will go and add some of the additional reactions. I should point out that if students plan on taking the MCAT, that then they will need to know a greater proportion of this. They'll need to know several additional pathways that are not covered in biological chemistry 1, but are covered in biological chemistry 2. You can also learn them by yourselves. The pathways that we do not cover are going to mainly be glycogen pathway, lipid metabolism, as well as pentose phosphate H1. Lipid metabolism and glycogen metabolism are very simple. Pentose phosphate H1 is a little trickier, but certainly you can do this by yourself. Yes, it does look like a subway map. And I actually, contrary to what some people may think, I actually think this is beautiful, although I don't know all the details either, but it does look quite beautiful and majestic. And so therefore, I like to show it. And there are really two types of metabolism that people look at. One is catabolism, the other one is anabolism. And catabolism is, as you might expect, based upon where people go and take steroids, right? So when go and take steroids, they generally take anabolic steroids. And what the anabolic steroids do is they go and build up your, what do anabolic steroids go and do?
Muscles.
Muscles, that's right. And so therefore, these go and build up your muscles. And so what happens here is you go and build up things. So anabolism means you're going and building something up. Catabolism means you're going and breaking something down. And generally this is to produce the basic molecules for building macromolecules. You digest proteins. It's also used for how you're going to get energy from your fuels. And that's an example of metabolism. Reactions that require energy are generally called anabolism. And please remember, the biosynthetic pathways and degradation pathways are almost always distinct from each other. Reactions along the pathway, and these reactions must be specific. No side product, that's generally very important. And generally, the pathway has to be favorable. Because if individual reactions along the pathway are unfavorable, that's not going to work. But please remember, when we talk about favorable and unfavorable, we're not talking about delta G zero. Delta G zero is the energy change under standard state conditions. Your body does not have one molar sodium ion, for example. And so therefore, when we're talking about this, we're talking about delta G. And delta G control takes into account the concentration of all the products and the starting materials. And so please remember that when we're talking about things being energetically favorable or energetically unfavorable. Generally, of course, that's the case. And I'll show you that on the next slide here. On the next slide here, showing the difference between delta G and delta G zero. And so therefore what happens here is we have delta G equals delta G zero plus RD ln CD over AB, products over reactants. Again, the thing that's going to be important here is delta G is not going to go and be delta G zero in terms of terming favorability or unfavorable. How you go and calculate delta G zero, that depends again upon RT ln KEQ. KEQ is the equilibrium constant, and so that gives you delta G zero. At equilibrium, delta G equals zero. Delta G zero clearly may equal something dramatically different. In biochemistry, as we mentioned before, the standard states are sometimes different. And so in biochemistry, people use delta G zero prime. This means that pH 7, not pH 0. The standard state for H plus, of course, is one molar. And so therefore it will be pH zero. Most reactions in biochemistry don't take place at pH 0, they take place at pH 7. So therefore, 10 to the minus 7 molar H plus is a standard state for delta G zero prime. In addition, water is given a concentration of 1, although in theory it should be around 55 molar. And again, it's highlighted in bold here, delta G is the important parameter, not delta G zero prime. So now, the problem that the body has, of course, is that it wants to make all the reactions to be favorable. How is it going to do this? Because clearly some reactions are unfavorable. And what it does is that it goes and couples. And generally, the one that it chooses normally is the hydrolysis of, any guesses? Or see, where do we get energy in the cell? ATP, bingo, hydrolysis of ATP. So generally, you cover hydrolysis of ATP with an unfavorable reaction. And shown here, we have two reactions. The first reaction is an unfavorable one. The second is a favorable one. When you couple them together, you go and get a favorable reaction. I should point out that delta G zero, the hydrolysis of ATP is somewhere around my 7 minus 8. kcals per mole. Inside the body, where the concentration of ATP is higher than ADP, the delta G, not delta G zero, but delta G, hydrolysis of ATP is in fact more negative than -8 kcals per mole. Shown here are the structures of ATP, ADP, AMP. I always get the question, do we need to know these? Given that you should know them already, the answer, of course, yes. Please make sure you know the structures of these molecules. Shown here is, again, what happens with ATP hydrolysis under del G0. It's minus 7.38 calories per mole. In vivo, again, this is because the concentrations of ATP, ADP are not one molar. ADP is higher than ADP. You get a del G of about minus 12 kcals per mole. ATP hydrolysis to AMP and to pyrophosphate, which is just two phosphates linked together, is around minus 11 kcals per mole for delta G0. In vivo, again, this number is more negative. So why get this energy for hydrolysis from ATP? Well, the first thing you want to remember about ATP is that ATP hydrolysis in the absence of enzymes is kinetically slow, and that's important. So not only here do you get lots of energy out, it's also kinetically slow in the absence of enzymes. So that means you won't produce lots of ATP, which then gets hydrolyzed just without doing any work for you. That's not going to be very efficient. And so therefore, ATP hydrolysis is kinetically slow, but it is thermodynamically favorable. So why is ATP hydrolysis so thermodynamically favorable? Well, what happens here is that you go, and when you break up the ADP into PI, remember ATP, we see in the previous slide, has lots of negative charges. And I didn't want to do that. And it has lots of negative charges. And so these negative charges are all together. And do negative charges want to be together? And the answer is no. And so what happens is that when we go and hydrolyze it into inorganic ADP, ADP has fewer negative charges. And so therefore, this is favorable because we move negative charges apart. Another thing is that you also have hydration. Now, normally what I do in class here to show hydration would be I would get three people to go and stand together. If you have three people going and standing together, it's very hard to hug the middle person. I know we want lots of love today, so make sure you go and hug your dog, cat, and family. And so therefore, what happens here is if you have little brothers and sisters around, you can try this, put three people together, the middle person is very hard to hug because the other two go and block them out. And so what happens is it's the same thing with hydration. If you have three phosphates together, it's very hard to go and hydrate the middle phosphate because the other two phosphates are blocked. If, on the other hand, you hydrolyze ATP to ADP, it's a lot easier to go and hug two people than it is to hug the middle person of three. Therefore, we get better hydration. The phosphate by itself, of course, can be very hydrated, and therefore that would help out. So hydration is, again, helpful. So therefore, hydrolysis of phosphate, or ATP, is something that's very favorable. And again, here, this is just the concept that you can shift equilibria by hydrolyzing ATP. Again, this shows you actual numbers. But again, the main concept is here we want to go and hydrolyze ATP, use that energy to make a reaction that's unfavorable to be favorable. Now, ATP is not the only molecule in the cell that contains high-energy phosphate. It's the one that's used most commonly, but there are other ones, some of which you're probably familiar with. PP is a very high energy phosphate. You get more energy from hydrolyzing ATP. These are delta G0 values than you do from ATP. Creatine phosphate is another one. Creatine phosphate is very important in your muscles. And so that actually is supplying the energy in your muscles to ATP. And so therefore, if you take more creatine, supposedly, it's going to go and help your muscles. Especially helps you with very rapid movements, such as lifting weight quickly. It's not going to help you with anything that involves long distances in general, because very little energy is actually stored as creatine phosphate inside your muscles, or ATP for that matter. Also, we have 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate. Again, these are all high-energy phosphate donors that you'll see later on. I would just go and remember the structures now. You can also remember them later, as we're going to see 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate and phosphoenolpyruvate later anyways. Creatine phosphate, we're not going to see again. But please do make sure you know what it is. Shown here are the relative energies for hydrolysis. In this case here, you see ATP is in the middle, and that's very important. The reason it's in the middle was if it was too high energy, it's going to be very hard to make, and that would not be very favorable. If it was too low energy, you wouldn't get enough energy out when you do hydrolysis to do much. That would not be very good. And so therefore, ATP is in the happy middle, just like with the experiment we were talking about before. And so therefore, that's where it's going to be. When we go and do exercise, we go and get ATP, and that goes, we don't have much ATP in our muscles actually, we reuse it over and over again. That will give us energy for a few seconds. Likewise, creatine phosphate, we don't have a lot of creatine phosphate in the cell. That's going to give us energy for a little longer, even, you know, unless it's something, you know, maybe a 100 meter dash, it's not going to give you enough energy to do much more. You then kick in with anaerobic metabolism, which we're going to cover in chapter 16. And then you go with aerobic metabolism, which is 17 and 18. Anaerobic metabolism is metabolism that takes place in the absence of oxygen. Aerobic metabolism is metabolism that takes place in the presence of oxygen. I should point out, you get a lot more energy out of glucose in the presence of oxygen than you do in the absence of oxygen. Now, glucose, of course, isn't the only fuel molecule. We also have fatty acids. Fatty acids, we actually get out more energy from than glucose on a per gram basis. But really, what we do is we go and burn alcohol and oil. And we burn these to CO2 and water. So yes, we contribute to CO2. And so that's how it works out. We're mainly going to focus on energy from glucose. We're not going to focus on energy from fats. Again, take biological chemistry 2 with Dr. Winkle. It's a very exciting class. And so take it. You'll find it a little easier than this one and probably a little more amusing as well. And certainly Dr. Winkle has more entertainment ability than I do. Here we also have the energy for different oxidation states of carbon. What you see here is that as you go from methane to carbon dioxide, what happens here is we go from methane to carbon dioxide, and as we do that, numbers become less negative. So that means when you go and burn methane, you get more energy out than when you burn methanol, than when you burn formaldehyde, than when you burn formic acid. And so what happens here is that the more CH bonds you have, the more energy you're going to get out from burning. And so therefore, you get more energy from fats, which have more CH bonds than glucose, for example, because glucose has a lot of OH groups. And so therefore, you're going to get a little less energy than you will from fats. So fats, more dense energy. The other thing to want to point out is that ATP is continually recycled. You can see that here. In many ways, you only have about 100 grams in your body. And so even on a relaxing day, which hopefully is like today, what you're going to get is you're going to get about 400 times each ATP molecule will be recycled. And so therefore, it goes back ATP, you make the ATP again from in your fats and glucose, and then it keeps on going. So my question is, how do you go and make these high-energy phosphate bonds? And this is generally made by oxidation, as we mentioned already. So how do you couple the formation of these high energy bonds to go and get, you know, in fact, ATP? What's shown here is one example. And so what happens here is that if you take glycerolide 3-phosphate and oxidized 2,3-phosphoglycerate, you're going to get out energy because you're taking aldehyde, which is the top carbon of the glyceraldehyde there, and you're going to go and make it into a carboxylic acid shown here at the top. And so, therefore, because you're making it into carboxylic acid, aldehyde to carboxylic acid is an oxidation reaction. It's going to be very favorable. So how might you go and couple this to go and make energy? And so what happens here is you could potentially, and this is used in vivo in glycolysis, take glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. As you oxidize it, you go and, in fact, use that oxidation energy to make a hydrogen phosphate at the same time. So what happens here is as you oxidize the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and transfer the blue hydride here to NAD, to make NADH, you also go and make a phosphate and hydride bond. And of course, this acylphosphate here, of course, is going to be high energy phosphate. This high energy phosphate then can be used to go and produce ATP. So by coupling these two reactions together, you can, in fact, oxidize glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and go and produce ATP. And so that works pretty well. You'll see this again in glycolysis. But the idea here is coupling reactions together, oxidation to ATP synthesis. Once you make the ATP, you then can go and do that to do lots of things. We'll go and talk about how oxidation can be used to, again, synthesize ATP in 16, 17, and 18. And also in chapter 18, making it clear how we can use a ion gradient to go and prepare ATP. So what happens in chapter 18 is we'll show you is that the cells use energy and NADH by oxidizing that hydride to water, go and pump photons out of a cell. This goes and creates a pH gradient. That pH gradient, then when the protons come back in, can be used to go produce ATP. And we'll go into this in great detail in chapter 18. We're not going to go into detail now. The other thing about metabolism, again, just to emphasize, is that it is very simple. It must be very simple. And so what happens is that generally there's you eat your sugars, you eat your amino acids, you eat your fats, you then break them down to all get broken down to acetyl-CoA. And the idea behind this is that you go and make the corresponding acetyl-CoA. Acetyl-CoA is a very simple molecule. This goes into the citric acid cycle, and this generates ATP. This part will be discussed in chapters 17 and 18. How is alcohol oxidized? If you drink ethanol in the body, you have an enzyme called alcohol dehydrogenase. Alcohol dehydrogenase oxidizes the ethanol to acetaldehyde. The acetaldehyde, of course, is not very nice for you, as it's been extremely toxic. So the acetaldehyde gets oxidized again to acetic acid through acetaldehyde dehydrogenase. The acetic acid then gets converted to acetyl-CoA, and the acetyl-CoA goes on and enters the citric acid cycle and oxidative phosphorylation. Shown here is the last few topics we're going to cover. And again, metabolic pathways contain activated carriers. We've shown activated carriers for phosphate. That's going to be ATP. There are many key reactions that are done repetitively, and we'll show you that in a few minutes. And then regulation. Shown here again is the structure of ATP. Generally, the beta and gamma phosphates, in this case, the two phosphates on the left-hand side. The one furthest to the left is the gamma. The one in the middle is beta. These are high-energy phosphates and used to go and generate energy. You can also use activated carriers for electrons. And in this case here, we have NAD. NAD is the structure on the left. We expect you to know NAD, especially the ring that is in red. Please make sure you know the ring in red, because that's going to be important going forward. We also have here the rest of the molecule. There's a small little yellow R group in the bottom right side. The difference between NAD plus and NADP plus is that NADP plus, that is a phosphate. In NAD, that is a hydrogen. So NAD and NADP plus have very similar sort of structures. The difference is a phosphate. One tends to be used for metabolism. The other one is used for catabolism. NADP plus tends to be used for metabolism. NAD plus tends to be used for catabolism. You also have FAD. Shown here is the FAD, which is on the right side. The important part of the FAD are these three rings at the top of the FAD. Please make sure you know the three rings at the top. And those are the structure. And these are activated carriers of electrons, which means they can get oxidized and reduced. And shown here is what happens with NAD+. If you're going to oxidize, let's say, an alcohol, you oxidize that to the aldehyde, or this is actually an alcohol to a ketone. If you take the alcohol, oxidize it to the ketone, the hydride, or the electrons are going to be transferred to the alcohol to NAD to make NADH. In this case here, this is a two-electron process and requires a proton. So here is FAD. FAD can be used to go and take an alkane to an alkene. In this case here, when you go and in fact oxidize the alkane to the alkene, you make FADH2. For the FAD, just the three rings would be fine. For the NAD, it would be just the one in red is going to be the most important one. For the here, the reason that they use FAD and not NAD plus here is it turns out energy for going and in effect oxidizing an alkane to an alkene is not enough energy there to make the NADH. And so therefore they go and make FADH2. The FADH2 takes less energy to make, and so therefore you can do it from that strategy. And you'll see both of these reactions many times over in the next few chapters. Shown here is the reduced oxidized forms of FAD and FADH2. And so please make sure you know the reduced and oxidized forms. Shown here in one case, I have the blue diene. This then is converted to an ene in the reduced form. So here you can see the blue nitrogens with the two double bonds on the left side, and then you just have the nitrogens are intervened between one double bond on the right side. Shown here is again how you might use the NADPH to go and make NADPH. Shown here is how you go and take a ketone and go and reduce it down to an alkene. If you take ketone and reduce it down to an alkene, what you can do, is that you initially normally take the ketone, you reduce it down to the alcohol. That gives you, in effect, two high energy electrons, which are used to make one molecule of NADPH. You then do an elimination reaction of water to make the alkene, and then you go and reduce that, make NADPH, and make the alkane. Again, you need to know the reactive sites on the coenzymes. That's correct. And again, this is something you're going to see when we take a look at chapter 17. So again, the idea here is just that you have activated carriers. So here is coenzyme A, and this is an activated carrier for acyl groups. Again, just know the red portion here so that you know what's attached to the acetyl group. You also have acyl groups attached as well. It doesn't have to be acetyl groups, acyl groups. The R group would be louder number of CH2 groups. Hydrolysis of acetyl OA is very favorable. It has a del G0 of around minus 7.5. Again, here, acetyl-CoA is kinetically stable, but thermodynamically unstable, which is important for all these activated carriers. What also is going to be important to realize is the del G0 value for acetyl-CoA is really similar to the del G0 value for what other molecule? And again, you can answer online on chat. Del G0 for hydrolysis of acetyl-CoA is very similar to ATP. That's correct. And so sometimes acetyl energy and acetyl CoAs or acyl CoAs are used to produce ATP. And so therefore you hydrolyze the acetyl CoA or acyl CoA and then use that energy to produce ATP. So that's another way of producing ATP. So again, the important overall considerations is these groups are kinetically stable, but thermodynamically unstable. And so that's how you get hydrolysis. And shown here is just a list of carriers and what they do. The ones that are going to be important for you are ATP, NADH, FADH2, coenzyme A, lipoamide, thiamine, pyrophosphate, biotin. The ones that you've seen with pretty much everything here, except for tetrahydrofolate, you're going to see in the next few weeks. Tetrahydrofolate, of course, is very important to take if you're pregnant. So we're going to see all of these again, so please understand what they do. Most of these activator carriers come from vitamins, and these are the vitamins that you see on your cereal box. So when you go and take your cereal box, you're going to see all of these. These go and are going to be important cofactors for these reactions and are used for activated carriers. Niacin is used for NAD, pantothenic acid, coenzyme A, biotin you take directly, riboflavin, and then we'll show you thiamine later on, the use of thiamine when we get to that particular part. And pyridoxal phosphate, we don't cover. That's covered in Biochem 2. But again, that comes from vitamins. So vitamins are going to be very important. I know we have several people that will pronounce it vitamins, but here we pronounce it vitamins. The last part here is to understand that there are really six key reactions that you're going to see about metabolism. In fact, all enzymes are numbered based upon these six key reactions. So enzymes are all given what they call an EC number, enzyme catalog number, and the first digit is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6. And that first digit depends upon the reaction. So if it's an oxidation-reduction reaction, then it's going to have 1. If it's ligation, 2, isomerization, 3, group transfer, 4, hydrolysis, 5, addition, removal, 5 groups, 6. And so that's how that works. Just showing examples of this. This is an oxidation reduction reaction. All of these reactions you're going to see again in 16, 17, and 18. So just understand what's going on here. In this case here, this is an oxidation reduction reaction. Here you're taking succinate, which has a saturated CH2 groups in the middle. You're making an alkene, and therefore that's going to be an oxidation reaction. This reaction is going to be catalyzed, as most oxidation reactions are, by dehydrogenase. And the dehydrogenase is going to be gone and named after the most reduced species. So the most reduced species between succinate and fumarate is going to be succinate. So this enzyme should be called succinate dehydrogenase. Likewise, here in the bottom example, you have an OH alcohol going to a ketone. That again is an oxidation reaction. It's again catalyzed by dehydrogenase. It's going to be named after the most reduced species. Alcohols are more reduced than ketones, so this will be called malate dehydrogenase. Shown here is an enzyme that goes and ligates carbons, And so generally these sort of reactions are going to require ATP because it takes energy to bring two molecules together. And so here, this is a ligation reaction. And this one you'll see again. Here we have isomerization. In this case here, the elemental composition of citrate and isocitrate are the same. However, the position of the OH is different. So these two molecules are isomers, and the enzyme that catalyzes these two reactions normally will be called isomerase. In this case, it has to be called something different, but that would be how it would work. We also have group transfers. Here, this is ATP, transferring phosphate to glucose. In this case here, this is called a kinase. Kinases are named after least phosphorylated species. This might be called glucokinase, although the most common versions are called hexokinase, as it also works with a few other sugars as well. Shown here is hydrolysis. We've seen that before with peptide hydrolysis. Here is addition removal. We'll see here in the bottom example, this is elimination of water. And so that's an example of addition removal. The top one is catalyzed by reaction. It's more complex. It's catalyzed by aldolase. Again, you'll see all of these again. Please know the six different types of reactions and see, please, and make sure you know what they are. Metabolic regulation is important as well, and we'll discuss that in chapters 16, 17, and 18. In this case, this depends upon the amount of enzyme. Transcription is going to be a way that that could be controlled. Also, the breakdown of the enzyme as well. We talked about allosteric control. We talked about covalent modification. These are all things that are important. One thing we didn't highlight before was substrate accessibility. The substrate and the enzyme have to be in the same compartment inside the body. Lastly, one thing that's very important for metabolism is the energy charge. In the case of the energy charge, we're going to go and talk about the amount of ATP relative to ADP and AMP, or we talk about phosphorylation potential. Generally, the more energy charge or phosphorylation potential you have, generally, the better off you're going to be. Please make sure you know what these are so that you can do it. Lastly, shown here is the ATP generating versus ATP utilizing pathways. Normally, in vivo, we have a relatively high energy charge between 0.8 and 0.95, and that's where, again, you get pretty much ATP generating pathways and ATP utilizing pathways having similar sort of rates. And so, therefore, that's something else to remember. That finishes chapter 15. What I'm going to do now is go and see if I can take a look at the file here. And so this is the worksheet that we handed out. It's a relatively simple worksheet, so it should be relatively easy to do. So the first thing is, what is the energy frequency for metabolism? And so that's going to be exactly. That's going to be ATP. ATP. And so that's going to be where you're going to get your energy from. Is synthesis of DNA catabolic or anabolic? DNA is a macromolecule, and so therefore it's going to involve the building up of muscles, the building up of material, so therefore that's going to be anabolism. Is glycolysis catabolic or anabolic? Glycolysis is a breakdown of sugars, and so because glycolysis is the breakdown of something, it's actually going to be catabolic, and so therefore it's going to be catabolic. It's going to be a catabolic pathway. Next here, we're talking about free energy pathways. What I'll do here is, given our time constraints, I will maybe go back and do that at the beginning of next class. Let me go and continue on here and do the easy examples, and then we'll go back and take a look at that. The following are activated carriers for what? Biotin is an activated carrier for what? CO2, that's right. So biotin is an activated carrier for CO2. NADPH is an activated carrier for electrons, that's correct. So this is going to be CO2. Electrons. And it's CoA is going to be an activated carrier for, that's right, acyl groups or acetyl. The last one here, give an example. Again, we just went through that on the PowerPoint. So I would go and see PowerPoint. So make sure you give an example for oxidation reduction, etc. Let's show here, go through the free energy quickly. Let's see if we can do that. So we're talking about the isomerization of glucose 6-phosphate to glucose 1-phosphate. So the way to do that is to realize that glucose up above give you the energy for glucose 6-phosphate going to glucose plus phosphate. And when we go and hydrolyze, and here we have water, and here the delta G for this is G0 is going to be minus 3.3. Now, what we want to do is transfer and do it to glucose 1-phosphate. So what we do is we go and take the table and we see glucose 1-phosphate. But because glucose 1-phosphate is a product, we're going to put glucose 1-phosphate on the right side. Glucose 1-phosphate plus water. And that's going to go to glucose plus phosphate. Now the energy for that on your table is minus 5. However, this reaction is not drawn in the forward direction, it's drawn in the backward direction. So that means the delta G0 for this is not going to be minus 5, but it's going to be plus 5. That's right, plus 5, because it's drawn in the backward direction. And now what I'm going to do is go and add this up. So I have my two equations, then I add them together. I see glucose on here, so I can cross that off. I see phosphate here, so I cross that off. And I left with, and I see water here. And so I'm left with glucose 6-phosphate going to glucose 1-phosphate with the isomerization of glucose. And I just add these two numbers together. And when I add the two numbers together, 5 minus 3.3 is going to be 1.7, and it's going to be plus 1.7. So therefore, the delta G0 for hydrolysis, for conversion of glucose 6-phosphate to glucose 1-phosphate is going to be plus 1.7. Does that make sense? So everybody's happy? Okay, so let's go and take a look here then at creatine phosphate to ATP. And so here again, we have creatine phosphate on the and this here has a delta G0 of minus 10.3 equals. That's 10.3. Now, in this case here, we want to transfer it to ATP. So here, we're going to make ATP. So again, we're going to draw this with ATP. And again, this reaction here is drawn in the backward direction. And because it's drawn in the backward direction, we're not going to use a negative number. We're going to use positive number. So here, delta G0 is going to be equal to 7.3. And so therefore, here again, let's go and cross off the things that are similar. And so therefore, we end up with ADP plus, I don't know what happened there. It went off the page. Plus creatine going to ATP, creatine phosphate, going to ATP plus creatine. And then we take these numbers and add them together, and we get, in fact, minus 3.0. So what that means is that I'm sorry about my handwriting, yes. So this gives you 3.0. And so therefore, what happens here is that this, in fact, is negative. Let me highlight the negative, 3.0. And so being negative 3.0 means that this is going to be a favorable reaction. And in vivo, in fact, you transfer the phosphate from creatine to ATP to generate ATP in your muscles, and you do this very commonly. This finishes today's part. Yes, minus 3.0 is correct. Minus 3.0 is correct. And so therefore, this finishes chapter 15. Please, I will post worksheets for chapter 16. Please do the worksheets for chapter 16. Also, please go and try and memorize the glycolysis pathway. So please, as your homework, memorize the glycolysis pathways, memorize the lipid, memorize gluconeogenesis as well if you have time. I hope the it got recorded today. I think it did, because I did it differently today, but let me see what I can do. Last time I thought I was recording, and it didn't record. This time I hope it is recording and we'll be able to do that. There have been a few technical issues, and we'll take care of that. Yes, the worksheets for chapter 16 have not been posted yet. They will be posted. The worksheets for chapter 15 and 12 have been posted and should still be available online. Any other questions besides the cat? We'll post the keys to the worksheets. We're hoping to give you the worksheets back again, but let me see if we can post the keys to the worksheet. Yes, that would be all. We'll do the same for all the worksheets. Sure, I can scroll over. I just don't know what part you want me to scroll over. This is the first part. It was anabolism, catabolism, ATP. And let me go and do the bottom part here then. And there's the worksheet being done. No, the worksheet key was not being posted. We were hoping to turn the worksheets back in. When we do get the exam, will it be all chapters? I am not sure what we're going to do about exams yet. The university is slowly sorting that out. And therefore, when it's sorted out, I will let you guys know. But quite frankly, I do not know what we're going to do. It seems that we're not going to have exams two. Oh, the worksheets are now locked. The worksheet's now locked for submission, but you should be able to see the actual blank worksheet because we locked the worksheets for the beginning of class. So, but the actual worksheet itself, you should still be able to see. Yeah, please submit the worksheets online. At this point, there's not much I can do, but we will please submit the worksheets to the appropriate outlet online. We're still sorting that out. I hope we will have that done shortly, and we will figure out what we're going to do. The cat. Okay, the cat right now is, oh, the cat looks like she just woke up. Let me see what I can do with the cat. The cat here, pretty. You want to come and say hi? Here. You ready to say hi? Okay, we're going to go and start the video now. Okay?
Is this live cat or is...
It's gonna be live cat, yeah.
Yeah.
So say hi to your fans, Manatee. Can you say hi? Okay. There. Are you having fun with your friends there, Manatee? Okay. You don't want to stay here any longer. Okay. So there's the
That's gonna be a 40-point question
did
on the test.
Did you see the cat or not?
What color is the cat? No, it isn't.
Yes, okay, good. So that would be the cat. The cat is running away now. She was so happy.